educational qualification. As if that's all that we need. Yeah, that's important, but it's not all we need to fix a nation, to fix a country, to fix a family. It's not about the prestigious university somebody attended. That doesn't hold water. Hallelujah. Now, how do we identify this wisdom of God? It takes place through vigilance. Let's look at 1 Peter 5:8. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant. Look at that. Because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Next. Resist him steadfast in faith. You can see the link between faith and vigilance here. It says, resist the devil steadfast in faith. Be steadfast in faith to the point you can resist the devil because he is your adversary. It says, be vigilant. Be vigilant. It tells you faith and vigilance work together. If you are not vigilant to see what is operating, the spirit at work per time, you cannot resist. You have to resist the devil when you know you are still steadfast in the faith. Resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. This is key. Be sober, be vigilant. Be vigilant. If you're not vigilant, you will not be able to deploy your faith very well. If you know you are getting too close to somebody and that it might lead to something that is negative, it says be vigilant to know that you must draw a line here. God is showing us a lot of times. I am wondering why this link between faith and vigilance. It says, be vigilant. Why? Your adversary, the devil, is looking for whom to destroy or devour. It says, resist him steadfast in faith. Steadfast in faith. Why faith doesn't work for many Christians today is that is because they are not vigilant enough. They are not observant enough. You cannot receive the devil if you are not steadfast in faith. Faith is required to resist the enemy before he can flee from you. But if you are not vigilant enough to see, that is a flee from the appearance of evil. That's God's wisdom. You are looking at God's wisdom. Faith, vigilance, patience. Hallelujah. Amen. Flee from the appearance of evil. That is to say, be smart enough to know that this thing would lead into something else. So how do we enjoy God's wisdom? The little areas that we are not so mindful of are the reasons we don't have faith working for us. Praise God. Let's look at the stories we put here. Exodus 3. The burning bush. Exodus 3. Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert, and he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. An angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of the bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire. He looked. Now, all of us look, but there's something behind what we are seeing. There is some hand behind the thing that has caught your attention. It might be something deeper than what we are looking at. So Moses looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire. but the bush was not consumed. There were other pastors by who looked as Moses did. But something made the difference. Something caused Moses to stay there to keep looking. Now, this tells me that as a child of God, I shouldn't be lost in the crowd. I shouldn't do what the crowd is doing. I shouldn't go by the majority all the time. There are other passers-by who saw the same bush as he was burning. But Moses looked, and he began to wonder. Go back to verse 2. Okay, leave it here. He said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight. Listen, there's no time God does not allow a great sight around you, trying to get your attention. Because why? The faith we are meant to use to get things done is the faith of God. That was just have the faith of God. There are things around you that is that amount to a great sight. I will turn aside and see this great sight. Why the bush does not burn? One book I read is titled, It All Begins with a Why. W-H-Y. The author is saying that the greatest of all inventions starts with a query, why? But today, when we ask why, we are so angry that the why we ask is not because we want to know, is that we have our minds made up. So we end up in error. Why isn't this bush consumed? Why do I find myself always looking in that direction? Could there be something behind what I'm looking at? Are there no signs around you? There's somebody, when a doctor was talking one day on television, he said, there's nothing like sudden death. He said, because there must be warnings. He said, it cannot be sudden because the person, only that's not alive to explain the signs he had been seeing before. He said, there must have been some signs, even if just once. There must have been some signs so that it cannot be called sudden death because the person cannot be not have known or seen or felt some things. So, and that got me curious. It means ours is life in Jesus, amen? And even long life, amen? But there are signs around us. This was a sign around Moses. Now, we're looking at God's wisdom. It was God's wisdom to appear to him in the bush. It was God's own choice or pleasure or wisdom to cause the bush to burn. So whenever God decides to catch attention, it is his choice as to how to get your attention. You are not to entertain. That's why you must every minute ask a question. Why am I here? Why am I still put under this person that does not like to see my face? There must be a reason I am still there. Rather than fight and complain and gripe and whine and say, but why is this nonsense? No, you must know that you are too special to God to be just in a place and there's no purpose. No. God is so mindful of you that everything about you is, it's having God's attention. God must be in the know of where you are, why you are there. You may not like it, yet it has pleased him to still keep you there. But because we have not been observant, we've not been asking questions, this man asks a question, why isn't this bush getting consumed? Why is it not burning? Why? This fire is too much, too big, not to have consumed this bush. The bush is looking green, as if nothing is happening. And here, this is a big fire. So you too should be that observant. be vigilant, because if it's the enemy trying to manifest and you are not vigilant enough, you can't resist him. Faith and vigilance go together. Go back to verse 2. The angel of the Lord appeared to him. Now, the angel didn't appear saying, Moses, I am angel of the Lord. It was just a fire that Moses saw. Just like other people that passed by saw. Hallelujah. So he looked. And behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Now, in his thinking, it was nothing as he was looking. He was thinking. The more he looked, the more he drew near. What was making him go near? The thought, why isn't this bush getting consumed? Or we find that in a particular the other day, one of us parked a car outside there. That was just a week ago. And I asked her, before the car was parked, I asked, what's your car number? I just asked. I didn't know why I asked. And she told me. And I looked at it. And the car now came, she brought it over. I said, okay. And as, some days back, some days after that, I was on the balcony. My company, and that somebody drove. I was coming into Sobo Arobiodu off my company, and it was red light, so I stopped. And behold, this car came from the other lane, I think, though it was going straight to my company towards Sheraton, and also just turned left by my side. Bam! Come back in front of me. So once it came on green, there's no way I could move without seeing the person. That was not good driving. I look at. Rather than get angry to the point I might begin to hate the person, I just calm down. I ask, could that be reason this person is driving like this? If that's something I have to notice, behold, as green came, I didn't struggle with the person. The number on the car was the same number of the car I saw in the church. Ah, I could not help me. Why the same number? Is there something in this number for me? Can I tell you this? I have been digging and digging, praying and praying over God. I know there's something particularly important about it. Third time, I woke up. As I woke, I put my phone from my drawer. It was off. As I put it on, behold, time. The same number of that car. Two cars now. One, I know the owner. The other, I don't know the owner. This time, it was the same number. I don't want to mention the number. I said, no, help me. There's something I said here. You see, these are signs. It's not only about the voice of God. No. God is going to use anything and everything to get our attention. But if we are not vigilant, if we are not observant, and we only want to depend on when we are fasting, and we want God to speak by force, so I'm fasting, God has to speak to me, He does not have to speak to you because of fasting. Fasting is wonderful. It's part of what you have to do in the kingdom. But we misuse fast a whole lot of time, because we don't know what fasting means. As that is clear, we see what God says about fasting there. You struggle and ask for understanding. But we have used fasting. Now, somebody feels God has to speak to him because he's fasting. He doesn't have to speak to you. He is always speaking. Before you fast, he is speaking. While you fast, you may choose to speak. After you're fasting, you will still speak. But if you think it's only when you fast, God you hear God's voice, that's not true. Because you'll be manipulating him. Then you'll be controlling God. You'll be trying to determine when God must speak to you. Why the bush does not burn? I will now turn aside and see this great sight. So it was the wisdom of God to get Moses' attention using the burning bush. They're looking at the wisdom of God, faith, patience, vigilance. That they all go together. Why faith? For all our faith to work very well. Imagine, at this point in time, next verse, as they turn aside to look more closely at the burning bush, when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, yeah, yeah. No wonder this man did amazing things. Think about it. All because as others passed by, ignoring the burning bush, he refused to ignore. When I watch any match, you see me watching something, I am looking out for what God may be saying. I ask the Lord, is there something you are communicating to me through that thing? You must ask that question. Why is this bush not burning? Or the traffic light, you've been on red for some time now, and it's like unusually slow. It's not changing. And you are there. Others are hooting. Wah, wah, wah. Don't judge them to hoot. There may be a reason the light has suddenly become faulty. This is the way we should be open to the Holy Spirit. So that any information he has for you, you can pick it up effortlessly. Hallelujah. He's always speaking. And just, are you driving? And before you know, somebody just some quick one to outwit you, and you get angry. It might be the kind of car God has blessed you with, you expect it. That person is just coming to show you the new car. But because of the lack of patience, that's the point that we are making. Because of that haste, that impatience, we are quick to make wrong conclusions. We are quick to get angry with people, to interpret people's action, people's statement, when we should have asked a question. Why did you say that thing? I'm not coming to ask in order to prove to what you have said, but I have come to ask because I didn't know. So, you know, you will get more. There are 4 things I said that girls don't do. The girls don't learn, we don't listen, we don't read, we don't think. 4 problems. I know you will not be like that anymore in Jesus' name. Next one. Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is only ground. Hallelujah. Next. Remember, he said, I'm the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. I love this story. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. For I know their stories. This is a major encounter. You can now see why. In God's own wisdom, it was that bush that was burning. So nothing is supposed to be ignored by you. For what is called ignorance is that which is available but you ignore. Simple. That's why we don't know. And we don't want to know. We ignore people, we ignore signs, we ignore things around us because we think they don't matter to us. It is called ignorance because you ignore what is available for you to know. It's not something that's not there, it's already in existence, which in your own wisdom you chose to ignore. And no, you paid dearly for what you don't know. Even God says his own people perish because they do not know. Because they ignore. For lack of knowledge. For ignorance. When you ignore what you ought to know, you're going to pay dearly for it. Hallelujah. Can you say that this black suit is black person? You can see that's in the arrangement. I just came the other day and I saw this. I said, okay, oh, I need to record myself. Devise this. So I was like, why would they think what pastor put in place? Ah, why don't you come down and watch him? There's always something God is speaking. Yeah. When we are so critical of other people, we, because what's causing that impatience? You're not so critical with people. You are quick to destroy their moods, to criticize everybody. Ah, by so doing, you struggle in the area of faith. Look at it. Moses got to know the reason for his being alive. The reason I saved you from being king of other babies, other Hebrew babies, Hebrew male children, is this. I have seen the oppression, surely seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. And I've heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their souls. So I've come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, land filled with milk and honey, and to the place of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Hezek, and Hittites, and Jebusites. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me. And I've also seen the oppression with which the Jews oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you. Look at it. That was a missile in the hands of God. It was to send Moses. God was going to send Moses. Come now, and I will send you. Send for his pleasure. What was God's pleasure here? To deliver God's people from the hands of the taskmasters. Can you imagine if Moses had, like other persons, ignored the bush? He would have ignored his calling. He would have ignored the purpose of God for his life. May that not be your person in Jesus' name. Listen, while people in pains are very impressed today, they have ignored a particular burning bush. They have been so critical of that burning bush, so judgmental of everything, even if it was a mistake. That you didn't like, it could have been allowed by God to teach you a lesson. Hallelujah. So we need to ensure that our faith grows and our faith works. How? By being vigilant, by being observant, by being patient, that we may understand God's wisdom. Don't forget, we're looking at God's wisdom. When He decides to use an unconventional way of getting your attention, and you are too polished, too busy, too critical, too judgmental, too angry, too upset to appreciate that thing. When small things upset us, we are actually messing up ourselves. Numbers 22. They're speaking us. Balaam, the prophet of God, have been contacted by Balak, saying, come and curse these people for me, that I may be able to overcome them. What does that tell you? What does a curse do? A curse is meant to weaken the capacity of somebody, so that whatever he does will always fail. That's what a curse does. Let's read. From verse 1. So come and curse these people in order for me to overcome them. Unless there's a curse on them, I cannot prevail over them. That's what the curse does. By the same token, a blessing that comes from the Lord is meant to empower you to the point whatever you do, you succeed in it. Yeah. Yep, no. From the first verse. Israel moved. He camped in the place of Moab, too. Balak, son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites. So, this Balak of a man was a wise man. Don't forget, everybody has wisdom. Everybody is wise. So, Moab was exceedingly afraid. This is the point. You've got to know that Even when you think, no miracles, I'm suffering, God is not listening to me, looking at me, the Moabites are afraid of you. This is the truth. This is the real thing. If you let what your needs are weigh you down, you'll be forgetting this secret that there's a future Moab now. It's a future Moab. There's a Moabite around you that's exceedingly afraid of you. Because what? They were many. Because God has been so big in your life, but you don't know because the enemy is telling you, you don't have this, you don't have that. Yeah. Suffering from that one, you are down this way, you are not up that way. They are all lies of the enemy. There's a Moabite that's afraid of you. He may increase the rent because he's afraid of you. You don't know. But when he's afraid of you, what do you mean? Why can't you? Would have you asked the Lord why the increase came? Why are you exasperated? Spirit of impatience. And that's why today people are going through what God did not allow them to go through. But His mercy will speak for you in Jesus' name. It's because we've been so, I'm looking for a word now. So intolerable of other people. So critical, so we nag a lot. A little thing that we should just smile and smile it off. We respond sharply. And so we grieve the Holy Ghost there. In the name of, I'm not in the right, I'm not in the mood. Ha. Who put you in that wrong mood? You put yourself there. So if you're not in the mood, then get back into the mood. Because you went into that wrong mood, you went in, now come out of it. If you choose to stay there, you are not having God's wisdom. They were exceedingly afraid of the king because they were many, and Moab was sick with dread because of his death. Moab was sick with dread. Look, imagine that, brother. Maybe the person is just afraid of you, but you don't know. You are complaining, you are grabbing, you are crying. Hey, that's glory, the person you see that frustrated this one, so that he does not become eternal to me. This one is having some potential as in this organization. I will flush out, you should know better, and just calm your head. Yes, ma'am. Come this way. I'm so sorry. What do you mean? It will happen again. Because you know what you are coming. You are going to respond in a negative way, you'll be messing up your future. Because there's a reason you are where you are. So Moab said to the elders of Midian, now this company will lick up everything around us. They have concluded that the Israeli camp will lick them all up. As an ox licks up the grass on the field. And Balak son of Zippor was king of the Moabites at that time. Look at the conclusion. But the people they were afraid of them. What is he? But look at it. He sends messengers to Balaam to call him, saying, look, our people have come to meet you. There's a church in Kedajian. Every one of them has a kind of look they carry. They look glorious. They are sharp. Somebody told me 3 days ago, face to face. He said, sir, I have been driving past your church fence. I have seen excellence. And I've heard that from different people. I tried to look through your gate, your fence rather, and your gate, and I see things are in shape. Things are put where they should be. Say, yes, sir. The church has not entered, but I can imagine how your hall will look like. Different. And those who have entered will say, hey, thank God for this place. Listen, somebody is afraid of you. This is God's wisdom. So don't respond in the negative way the person is operating. All right. See, they cover the face of the earth. And they are settling next to me. somebody would like to let us be here? No, we are scared. And we will go take over their own church. Members will leave their church and come here. They are afraid of that. Therefore, come at once. Please, cast this food for me, for they are too mighty for me. Look at it. Perhaps I shall be able to defeat them and drive them out of the land. For I know that he whom you bless is blessed, he whom you curse is cursed. So perhaps I will be able to defeat them. Because if they weren't going to be cursed, he was not going to be able to defeat them. Because he learned this from Deuteronomy, your chapter. Balaam. Balak's messengers came. Said, our king has sent us to you. He has promised to honor you, to promote you, to do this if he can come and curse these people that are dangerous. And Balaam said, I will go to God and get an answer for him. Before he went to God, God came down to him. God came down. God, he was coming to you. He was already deceived. Before I could go to God, God came down. He said, no, but I saw you coming. Here, don't follow them. Because I've blessed these people. They cannot be cursed. As I put it to you, even if a curse has been working against your life, it is thereby destroyed in Jesus' name. It will never work against you again in the name of Jesus. Believe me. So, move on to verse 34. You know the story, so don't go back and read it. Do not fight it. Eventually, Balaam, because of covetousness, she wanted to go and actually went. Eventually, God said, well, since I know you want to go, I permit you to go with her. But whatever I tell you is what you have to say. Don't speak King Balak's words, speak my words. As we were going, the donkey simply turns to one side. And Balaam almost held them. Balaam, please do nothing. Why would you want me to fall down? You want to kill me? Second time, the donkey turned as if running from something. It went on like that. And Balaam said, if I had the sword, I would have killed with that sword. And the animal spoke, have I ever done that to you before? Am I not your donkey? He said, yes, you are. Have I done this to you before? He said, no. Then why are you trying to kill me? Then, look at it. Then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey. And Balaam said, the donkey said, what have I done to you that you have struck me these 3 times? Balaam said, because you have abused me, I wish there were a sword in my hand, for now I would kill you. The donkey said to Balaam, am I not your donkey? Ever since I became yours to this day, was I ever disposed to do this to you? And he said, no. Prophet and donkey were talking. Because there is oh my God. Then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way with his drawn sword in his hand. He bowed his head and fell flat on his face. And he said to him, why have you struck your donkey these 3 times? Behold, I have come out to stand against you. God said, you have come out to stand against Balaam. Balaam didn't know. At times when God is the one who is assisting you, standing with you, you have been leading the devil. Behold, I have come out to stand against you because your ways perverse before me. The donkey saw me and turned aside from me 3 times. The donkey saw the angel. The prophet did not see. How was the animal able to see? I don't understand that. The Bible says God has to open the lamb's eyes to see. We need to pray that God open our eyes to see the little signposts here and there. One day, We set up, we were not married then. We left Abeokuta for Ileton. Was it the body of Abeokuta? Abeokuta for Ileton. To attend the wedding of a sister. A member of our group in church. And I was their leader. We got to Ibadan. We're not looking for Easter vehicle. Suddenly, I saw that all over me, palm oil. Soaked, not drinks of, I mean, as if somebody carried the bucket of palm oil and poured on me. And it was that bad all over me, all over. How? I still could not explain. Even to this, I can't figure it out. Where is this much palm oil? I'm talking of somebody with a bucket of palm oil pouring on you, on your head, right from my shoulder down. Where? I didn't meet any palm oil seller. This is bus stop or motor park. How? It was a sign. Which should have made me know that that journey was not a good one. But I didn't listen. Oh, yeah? Ask her. I don't want to name that one now. It was too much. They had to pour kerosene on me. They had to pour in bottles of kerosene on my dress. I was smelling like we were going to burn this mama. Because this was so much. I wonder, how did you get this? No palm oil seller here. They were pouring kerosene on me so that I might go to that event. And I still went there. I was worse than Balaam. You think you know me? I'm not telling you about me. Hey! We went to that Easter for the wedding. Ask her what she passed to coming back. We got to Ibadan by past 11 p.m. Oh my God. Did you get up together that night? We got our partner by 11 p.m. What kind of life was that? Almost midnight. He didn't say one word, whether it was a kidnapper or armed robber or a doctor, we didn't know. The evil outing. Well, I said, get out. He could have gone to kill us. How would have been? The palm oil was enough sign. Oh my God. Yes, not because I had anything to gain. I was just there like a curious cat. I remember that thing, you know, so I bless you. Now, look, so this is what you are making it. The faith, your faith, receives strength from your patience, your vigilance. Maybe the job you are doing, there were signs enough to tell you, slow down. This job is good, but it's not going to help you. The person I'm going to be working with, you won't be able to come. And this department, saying, I'm okay. Signs are always there. That's what I'm making this evening. God is always showing us signs. Signs always come from the Lord in His mercy. Hallelujah. Verse 24. And Balaam said to the angel of the Lord, I have sinned, for I did not know. You stood in the way this week. You didn't know. But the animal knew. So what he could have known if he wanted to know. It's what you're making. Pastor was praying the other time, saying, Lord, we could have done something by now or on our way to some place. We have to stay back. I want to see why. So I have to stay back. Down south. They always say, God does not leave us without His Son. Because He loves us. Hallelujah. Demons came away against me. Now look at what He said. Therefore, if He pleases you, I will turn back. Didn't he know that I didn't please God at all? He still wanted to go. If he pleases you, I will turn back. Let's look at Genesis 28. 28. Verse 16. It's like Jacob here. He had a dream. Go to verse 14. He had a dream. Okay, 15 now. God was speaking to him in that dream. Behold, I'm with you. I will keep you wherever you go. I'll bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I've spoken to you. That's your case too. God says he will not leave you until he has done for you all he has promised you in the name of Jesus. You've got to believe this and cheer up. Speak it out. No matter what has happened, it is in your past. Amen? It says he will not leave you until he has done what he has spoken to you. Don't you like that one? Amen? Hold on to that one and let the pain you feel now not tie you down. The future is brighter than the present pain you carry or you pay the past today. Hallelujah. Verse 16. But Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place and I did not know it. No. The Lord is in this place right now. I didn't know. Why didn't he say, and I don't know? So he could have known this thing if he was vigilant enough. So why we think our faith is not working is because even after praying for A, B, C to take place, and God in his wisdom responded, he will have sent some signs to encourage you. That I heard your cry. The answer is on his way. Hallelujah. It may take a while to manifest, but this something will be there to assure you that yes, God answered you. Glory to God. And we stood under a tree there for 13 Sundays, non-stop. And yet we came every day, every Sunday rather. 4 hours, 3 hours of service. We didn't do any microwave oven service. We took our time to bless God. All of us standing, all through. Remember, what a sign we saw. Nobody ever came to say, what are you doing here? No government official, no security personnel, they would just drive past, look at us, slow down, look at us, and zoom off. There was never anybody stop and said, why are you pulling up to? Why are you planning? This is for the church. No, God left them. And answers. That was the sign. But if anyone left that moment, for that reason, some still left us. So we can't study all the time forever. How do they feel now that we are not part of this place we are in? Don't they feel like they left the right place? They labored with us, but they were too much in the haste. They couldn't wait for the signs, the signposts that God normally sends to sustain his people and prepare them for the manifestation of what he has done. God has a way of sending things to you, people to you, to strengthen you, to make you know that he is really there with you and for you. But if you don't look at those signposts very well and use them to add 2 to 2 and get 4, you'll be discouraged. God was there. Jacob didn't know it. He wanted to ask, Lord, why? Can I say again? Can I eat again? Papa, now resting in the Lord. Said, one day he went to a country. So that county, in the US, a country, said, America. I think in the US, they country there, a state. So as he entered that state, there was power outage. Everywhere went dark. Boom. You know, here is the normal thing here. Over there is not normal. And he was asking, this is strange. making things change, and has power out change. What a sign in this age. Lord, why? So God told him, because of my presence with you. The enemy is angry with you. Because you carry all of me. Come. And that person has started getting angry. Or will have been afraid if he baptized the bad end of this thing. That means God listened to him. If I came in here and there's black eyes, that was the devil's degree. Because he didn't bother to ask. But this man said, Lord, why? I want to know. I know you are with me. Is there a good sign from you? How do I know? How do I do this? So no, it is because of my presence. It is very, very heavy. The enemy is fighting back. Because the enemy is that his son is not in this church. The light has come. Don't worry. The Lord is encouraged. Maybe you've not been asking God for a sign as to why he has left you there in that situation. Rather, I could be asking Lord, and I have tried to change this thing. It's still like that. What? 2 Corinthians 12. Wasn't that Paul's prayer? He said, three times I sought the face of God to take this thing from me. And God kept saying, no. My grace, 2 Corinthians 12. My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. So, look at it. Verse 7. Okay. Let's ask the exalted. Okay, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord that three times that it might pass from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. So there was something that was always coming to trouble me. That was the sign from God. And Jesus, I pray, Lord, this thing must stop. He said, no, no sickness, please. No. God wished to just to try to test you. No, please, no sickness. But this was something said to boost him. Maybe someone, somewhere there, is always after you. It could be the Lord's plan to help you know that his own grace is increasing with that punishment you are going through. That's why the person always harasses you, always criticizes you, always will say, who is it here? It is because God is trying to strengthen his grace upon your life. You see that same person always harass you. If you don't get the signs right, you will fast forward or rewind God's plan. And neither of the two is good enough. You got it? Most gladly, therefore, I would rather boast in my problems, in my infirmities, that the power of Christ be rest upon me. Because he had a child of God. Why is this thing always coming to torment me? Why? He said, no. My grace is more than enough for me. We are looking at grace. I mean, faith, patience, vigilance, and the wisdom of God. This was God's wisdom here. By sending that thing to always torment Paul, that was God's wisdom, which he was praying against. Because he said, don't pray against it. Just claim the grace I've made available. Because whenever there's weakness in your life, my own grace is 100% available. When you sense anything that is always a recalling this man in your life, not think you have caused, not by laziness, no. Whenever it's about that, no matter what you do, it could be that which you have grace to handle. Yeah. So many instances in the scriptures. So we need to know. So look at St. Paul here. His faith was mega. But look at the things they have to contend with. And always, these people would seek the Lord. Why is this so? Look at Paul asking why. Why is he coming again, and again, and again? And God said, rather than trying to stop it, no. Just claim grace. The more this weakness is in your life, the stronger my grace is available. Isn't that awesome? Shout hallelujah. This is the wisdom of God, which we need patience. Vigilance, endurance, to really appreciate. I remember when I was in our church, Methodist Church in the Bible, 1973 or 4, now 5, I forgot it. And I saw this bus, Methodist Secondary College, Sagamo, a Toyota Costa bus. And I just liked it, like that burning bush. Ah, I like this bus. And I desired to be in that school. I didn't know anything, whether it was a good school or a middle school. I just liked the bus. It was the bus that was the attraction. Before I knew it, I wrote an entrance exam to Wesley College. Wesley College, 1996. Wesley College. And I was admitted. But in the same year, they broke Western State to three states, or Yon, Do, and Ogun State. So, as I was in Wesley College, I said, no, you are now from Ogun State, not Western State. Go to your state. And you are going to this school. It became that same school. Yeah. It was Wesley College I was admitted to. In New Caledonia. And they look at it. Because I had had an attraction. So it was no longer the bus, it was God behind the bus. They said, now that there's Ogun State after Ogun State, we are from Ogun State, go to your state. We have forwarded your admission letter to MTTC Sagamu. That bus I saw in our church, months or years back, became the school I was to attend. So now I know better. That was not, I liked the bus, because it was the burning bus. I was not consumed. Do you hear me? The burning bus. It was God behind the bus. Again, I was in Abeokuta. I saw a stadium, then I moved on around the stadium. And I said, well, after the match, that I forgot which teams were playing. I saw the surgery bus of Ogun State College of Education. Ah! I said, look at this one. Look at that good school. I didn't know any better. I just liked the school because of the bus. Before I knew it, I became a student of that school. Oh, yeah. I'm trying to show you that what we are today could have been influenced by some signposts around us that we did not take seriously. It could be God behind it all. Hallelujah. So what are the signs you have been ignoring? Don't ignore them anymore. Before you complain, calm down, please. Ask a question. Why this? Not why me? Why me? Why always me? Why? Why? Why not another person? No. Just calm down because you are stressed. Hallelujah. This is what makes faith very strong. When others are complaining, you are just calm. No wonder when, in 1 Kings 17, when the brook dried up, Elijah didn't pray any prayer. Can you imagine that? He was so calm. Why? He has seen a sign before that the ravens brought food morning, evening for him to eat was enough for him to do that. No matter how dry the brook became, he would never make it a prayer point. His faith had become so solid because of the signs around him. Hallelujah. In John 11, Jesus stayed for 2 extra days before going there to see Lazarus, who was now dead. Why? There were signposts around him that did not favor his going there that time. Look at this. Psalm 31, 22. Psalm 31, 22. And Psalm 116, verse 11. Psalm 31, 22. And 116, 11. Yeah. Look at this. The psalmist said, I said, in my haste, I am cut off from before your eyes. In his haste. You can see what haste does. Haste makes your faith go down. Hey, haste. Haste would deflate the tire of your faith. Haste would make your future tire to go flat. I tell you. So that's why we're going to go into faith work. He said, it doesn't work. It's not working. You tried it, as Pastor said, it's the only person is working for. It's because of the haste in your life. Look at it. He said in his haste, I am cut off from before your eyes. Look at him and said, nevertheless, you heard the voice of my supplications and I cannot unto you. So why did he say that in his haste? When he said we have been cut from God's eyes, at that point, was he said, see her, his feet have gone down. Can you imagine that? Next one. Romans 6:11. Again, the same man. I said in my haste, all men are liars. I was in the bank one day, and one man was talking to a bank official. He said, he was talking about pastors. He said, all pastors, they are all rogues, they are all adulterers, all of them. And they asked him, how many? He said, how many do I know? All of them. And I was right beside him. All of them, they are stripping their members, they are taking people's wives from them, all these pastors. I will never preach to any church because nonsense pastors, they are just, at some point, I looked at his face. I tried to look at him with that kind of look. Maybe he will stop. He continued. No. All men are liars. Again, he said in his face. This is the reason people's faith is not working. This conclusion is so bad that if you say all pastors are liars, no pastor will bless you anymore. That's the implication. Oh, all pastors are humanizers. Every pastor that comes, they say, how are you today? He say, what's in there? That's how they start. At that point in time, God cannot bless you through that person. That is why faith does not work for many. They are too much in a haste to complete. Look at this over-generalization. I've been cut off from your eyes. At that time, his faith was totally out. All men are liars. A lady, I've told you a number of times, a lady and her friend, rather, were talking by my window in the garden those days, many years ago. And as I heard that statement, all men are the same. They are useless. They are unreliable. All men, all of them. I began to kick my window. The person you know that I will not mention them. And so see, I said, okay, sister, let's see, okay. And I watched. All men, she said, when it was time to marry, she could not have married a good man. Because by his own, her own conclusion, all men were evil. She was only going to, was going to marry one of the evil men. And an evil man actually came her way. And there was nothing they didn't do to make it work. An evil relationship killed the pastorness. Her faith to get a great home didn't work because of her haste about all men. Think about it. The struggle, I want to do this, I want that, right now working, one disciple was in prayer. Somebody here, you know. Don't press, I was seated there. That's what he said. If the pastor is working for, let's pray to you that our faith too will work. Ka-ka-ka-ka-ka. He says, even prayer, this person was then, no, because this was still there, for the better. That person was always in the house. Always angry with everybody. How could faith work for that kind of person? Who would not be calm enough to see what God is doing something? Hallelujah. In closing, I give you this. Exodus 13:17, Exodus. Then Job 29:16. This is the truth to close. Exodus 13:17, Job 29:16. Came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. So this is the point. We are talking of God's wisdom. So that, because it's not going to come through your own wisdom. No, it will use the wisdom to have His way in our lives. Because we are used to our wisdom, when some wisdom is on display, we don't seem to acknowledge it. We want it based on our wisdom so we can relate to it. Look at it. This was God's wisdom. He said, the way of the land of Israel was near, but God said, was God speaking to nobody? He was speaking to himself. It was in his thoughts. God was speaking here. God said, now as God thought, he was speaking to nobody, so he was only thinking. He said, let's perhaps the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. I will take them through a longer route by way of the Red Sea. Hey! The land of the Philistines is very, very near, but they will see war and return to Egypt. Times when you want the answer, oh, let the church grow. Why are we not growing by now? If you look at the trend, by now we should be, it is not 2+2 looking for. That's not ministry. In ministry, 2+2 can be 24. 4+4 can be 1,000. Because one person will chase how many? 1,000, 2 will chase how many? That's not mathematically correct. It's not 2,000. I can want 600 and 2 will chase 10,000. That tells you 2+2 is not 4 in the ministry. Oh, in 3 months, when I was sent to Ibadi, I took my target there. In 1 month, we'll be this number. Kala, ba. Ribro, standard. In 3 months, Yahibo, Kalibo. By 6 months, we are this number. When the Israelites dawned on me, I said, I'm here for you. It's not a man and a woman. People came and left. They kept coming and kept going their way for no reason. Ah, what's happening here? God was using that to teach me patience. So when somebody is not broken, you still are looking at him, still gra. He's advising you, you know that. Okay, man. But that is, it's fine. Next verse. So they took their journey from Sukkot and encamped in Ephraim. At the edge of the wilderness. This was God. It is wisdom. He didn't tell anybody. None of them knew this wisdom of God. He just found it was getting so long, so long, so long. Oh God, why? In his wisdom, he said, I know what I'm doing. At times, what will cost happens in 6 months, may take 6 years. And you're wondering, but why? But why? Well, why? Have I not prayed? I've fasted? I've given offering? I've given this offering? I've given me two. I was the father to the poor, and I searched out the case that I did not know. Is key. The case you don't know, search it out. What you don't know, ask questions. Job said, what he didn't know, he searched it out. But today's Christian will not search it out, rather conclude in error. Rather ask questions, why is this so? I don't know. Somebody cannot start the money just on this today to ask me a question. And that was what I was going to conclude upon on Sunday. Last Sunday, this week, 3-4 days ago. I said, well, that's because you're not used on Sunday. You're here. You said, yes. So I was going to conclude that, but no time, because it took a while to explain it. And I liked that. He came to ask that question. I said, he said, sir, you answered it. That's it. What you don't know, search it out. Ask questions, because if you conclude in error, it will be too bad. Your faith can never carry it. When there are wrong conclusions, they affect faith. Yeah. See, if your faith is not on balanced scripture, that's the problem. So faith of God works well. With patience, vigilance. When God's wisdom is on the field, God will never come through your own wisdom to you. It will come through his own wisdom. Look at all we feared. They were all God's own way of fixing the things. The people in there to know and make amends. Hallelujah. It's my prayer tonight that supernaturally, whatever you have lost, or we may have lost, for whatever reasons, because of our haste, lack of vigilance, etc., etc., there's restoration in the name of Jesus. Receive restoration in the name of Jesus. be restored in Jesus' name. As a ministry, we are restored in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Stand up and pray. Claim it. Claim it. Claim what you've lost. Claim that which you could have gained but became pain. Claim it back. Supernaturally. Claim it back. That point at which you find difficult to listen to correction. That which you didn't see, as somebody said, you didn't see, there was a sign around the eye. Tell me, don't tell me. That is the sign that you need to deal with. Pray for the return of all that is yours, based on the wisdom of God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, precious Father. We bless your name, O God. We exalt you, Daddy. Thank you, Jehovah God. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Father, thank you for your word.